one seat, the movie is one place, the other thing is one place. The moment you come in the morning, you are like, is this a house or what is this? Right? You have instructed one of your child that he has to do this. And you come down in the morning and you find that the newspapers are scattered all over. What will you tell the child? What's the normal reaction? How many times have I told you to do this? Doesn't it get into your head? Is this a house or is this a madhouse or what? Right? Or the best is, what's wrong with you? The ultimate kind of insult is, what's wrong with you? Doesn't it get into your head? No, does it help the child to react to you? How does the child react when you do that? Right? He says, did you see me mom? Yesterday I had an exam, I was studying late in the night, so I didn't get up in the morning and do it. No, there's a difference always. When you attack, there's a difference. So is that the way to talk? Actually, we have not learned to talk or to ask our needs and wants to be fulfilled without stepping on people's toes. Every time we think, either we have to attack them or we have to take it for ourselves. No, it is not done, so I'll do the whole thing, I'll blame myself for the whole thing. Or I'll blame the other person for the whole thing. We haven't learned to balance, how do I do this? I want to tell, have a difficult, this is a difficult conversation to have. There's a distress here, that in the sense of, the things are not as you wanted. But that person has not done it, how do you address it? Don't begin it with criticism. The moment you begin with criticism, there's going to be a huge turn off for the other person. He's going to come and reverse attack you for something or the other. Right? You didn't do this, I did this, it's going to be two my man, it's going to be a battle all the time, right? So never start a difficult conversation with criticism, it doesn't lead us anywhere at all, right? The second point is, use I statements when you want to make feelings. What does I statement for feeling mean? That when you have a feeling, that feeling is yours, right? It's not the other person's feeling. The other person is not making you feel frustrated, right? Don't start by saying, you are making me really frustrated to see these newspapers all around, right? You really make me angry when you don't take the garbage out. You make me angry, you make me feel frustrated, you make me feel depressed. When we say you and my feeling, the other person will say, who's asking you to feel like that? Right? The normal next person is asking you to feel like that. You say, you are making me feel frustrated. Don't feel frustrated. Who's asking you to feel frustrated about it? Isn't it? But when I use an I statement for it, when you say you statement for a feeling, you are blaming the other person. Right? It is the beginning of another war in the house or a blame game. It starts off by saying, you did this to me. Okay, you did this to me yesterday, you did that to me. It just goes off into that. It doesn't solve any issue. But when you own the feeling, you say, I feel frustrated when you do this, you are pointing it in action. You are saying, when the newspapers are scattered, I feel frustrated, not you make me feel frustrated. There's a huge difference between saying you make me feel frustrated and I feel frustrated. When I say I feel frustrated, I am even educating the child that the feelings are always yours. Right? You can do whatever you want. You might not have taken the garbage out, you might have scattered the newspaper all over, you might not have put the shoes in the right place. That is an action which I don't like. But what the result of that action is my feeling, not you make me feel. The moment you say you make me feel, it's going to be a battle between two people. So do not always use, for whenever you want to use a feeling statement, use an I statement for feeling. I feel frustrated, I feel angry, I feel hurt when you do this. You are pointing out the action of the other person and the feeling is yours. Separate the feeling and the action. Don't put the feeling blame on the other person. The person is not going to like it. I didn't make you feel like that. No, because nobody likes the idea that I made you feel angry, I made you feel frustrated. They are also always going to respond with a defense. Right? So use always I statements for feelings. And third is, disclose your feelings. Even if it's a child, disclose your feelings. We always hesitate somewhere to disclose our feelings. I am feeling upset, I don't want to tell the other person because what will the other person think? No, he may feel upset because I am feeling upset. If I tell him that I am feeling upset, the child may feel upset about it. It's not at all true, but use I statement and disclose your feelings. You need to disclose your feelings. Mind reading is not communication. Everybody who has got a spouse knows that mind reading is not communication. Is that right? We expect, even if you have been married for 20 years, you still have to tell the person what you want. Once in a while, somebody reads your mind and gets you, that's a big surprise. Right? Don't expect that to happen every day. Mind reading is not communication. And that is true even with children. You can't expect them to read your mind. So do not expect mind reading. Disclose your feelings. It's important to disclose your feelings. Right? Then the fourth would be, give up the fight to be right. Very difficult? Is it very difficult to give up the fight to be right?
Yes.
Like we always, how many battles happen in the house to say that I am right, you are wrong? Isn't it? All arguments, all our fights are about, I am right, you are wrong. I need to prove that the other person is wrong. Let me ask you this. How many of you have the experience of the wet towel on the bed? Almost every household, wet towel on the bed. The World War I maybe occurred for 13 years. The World War II maybe for 15 years. The battle of the wet towel on the bed is eternal, right? It's a lifetime battle. As long as you're married, you're going to have the wet towel on the bed going on. But when you do that, what are you achieving by that? You know, in one way, when I say give up the fight to be right, what I'm saying is, when you want to point out to something that the other person has not done, do not use long sentences. No, do not use a long sentence. How many times do I have to tell you about the wet? Do you want me to sleep on the wet bed? Don't you see this thing? Doesn't it get into your head that the thing is getting wet? No, long sentences are not necessary. Use the shortest possible sentence. If your child's name is Sanar, just say Sanar. Right? You just have to say Sanar and look at the thing, it might work. Or suppose you don't want to use the name, just say wet towel. No, do we have to even use the name? If you use the name, again there could be a defense action from the other side. Right? Just say towel, wet towel. You know, it might help, isn't it? Somebody asked me, can we convey our displeasure without words, just a body language? I said, why not? Just do. And how you do matters. You know, whether you do it with a lot of anger, whether you do it with a lot of resentment. Clearing your throat is communication, right? Mind reading is not communication, but clearing your throat is a communication. Can we communicate to people without long words? You know, giving up the fight to be right is, I don't want to be proving right and wrong all the time. If you understand it, it's all about opinions, right? Are you arguing about facts? Are you arguing about opinions? Most of the time, it's all about opinions, isn't it? There's nothing fact. If there's a fact, anybody can prove it. And we're not arguing about facts most of the time. We're arguing about what I think and what you think. My thinking is better than your thinking. My thinking is more correct than your thinking. What do we achieve by proving my thinking is today? Suppose you are able to prove, the other person may say, okay, you are right, I am wrong. You might go away, but there is a resentment building up. You know, there is a resentment building up of you are right, I am wrong. What we call gunny sack, you know, all of us have a gunny sack. We keep putting all the negative things, oh, he said, that day she said this, that day she said this, the whole thing, and the gunny sack is empty. One day we come and put it on your head. Now all the old things will come back right from the time of Akbar, you know, whatever you did that day, you did this day, you did this. No, it just goes on like that. So give up the fight to be right. When you give up the fight to be right, you're not arguing about opinions. It's true for children also, isn't it? When we look at children, we have to understand that we are communicating for, and we are, what you say, counseling for a generation gap. No, we have to understand that there's a generation gap between us and the children. You know, we might have put oil in our head, we might have tied it as a bunch of when we were kids. Today, now they'll put, what do you call it, highlights, gel, and there will be a spike. Is that right or wrong? Is it right or wrong? Is there anything right or wrong about it? You would have been dead rather than being caught with wearing torn clothes, right? Today, if there are not three holes on the jeans, you know, their dignity is lower. My friend has two holes, I've got only one hole, it's not good. You have to compete with number of holes in the jeans, isn't it? And let's say even your age, you might have, all of us might have got our ears pierced and maximum nose piercing. Today there's no body part left that is not being pierced. I don't want to go into details of which body part left because this is not that kind of a class. Right? Every body part is pierced. Is this right or wrong? What do you argue about? Right? It is a fashion, it is their culture, it is their peer group, it puts them into that kind of a thing. So if we are arguing about right and wrong, we don't get anywhere because it's an opinion, it's a trend, it's a fashion. Whatever happens, you may not like it. I'm not saying you have to approve of it. I'm not saying, okay, you want to punch your body, let me take you to wherever you want. You don't have to do that. Make it difficult for them if you don't like it. You go and do whatever you want. I'm not coming along with you for doing this thing. So there's nothing like right or wrong when it comes to fashion, when it comes to opinions, when it comes to trends. You know, so don't believe in fighting for right or wrong because most of the time you spend in proving right or wrong. Right? So give up the fight to be right or wrong. This is a very difficult skill to practice, to give up the idea of not wanting to fight to be right or wrong. So if you can do that, it helps a lot in communicating with even children. The fifth would be, don't communicate when you're angry. This is the most, it's again very difficult to do, isn't it? When we're angry only, we want to tell 100 different things. Right? We've got so much of boiling energy inside us when we're angry. At that time, we want to tell all the things. But normally what happens is, when we communicate when we're angry, see, there's one reason why we need to communicate. We need to communicate, if it is essential, we need to communicate that I'm angry angry with something, right? Can I communicate that anger without getting internal anger? You know, I want to show my anger to my child because I want to say that I am disapproved of what you have done. You have to do that as a parent or as a counselor or as a teacher, whatever. You need to show your disapproval. Can you show your disapproval without getting angry internally? You know, there's a lot of difference between getting internal anger and external anger, isn't it? I'm showing my anger for a purpose. That's for communicating with the child that I disapprove of. But if I'm really angry, don't communicate with children or even with adults. Because you tend to make a lot of mistakes when you communicate with child. You're going to regret what you're going to say. But if you're really angry and want to communicate, just move away from that. It's one of the best things that you can do. Right now, I don't want to talk to you. I'll talk to you later today, or you can even mention, I'm very angry right now, I don't want to talk to you now. We'll talk about this later. Right? You also cool down, the situation cools down, and then you sit and discuss things. Things can work out. The last would be gender differences.
You said you can show disapprovement without internalizing anger, but just that.
What I'm saying is, I want to see, I feel like, oh, my child has done this, I don't like it. So I have to show anger to him. You know, I'm displaying an emotion of anger without feeling angry. That's why I gave you the distinction of feeling and emotion. Feeling is what I'm feeling inside. Emotion is what I'm displaying outside. I'm displaying an emotion of anger, but I'm not feeling angry inside. That's a message that I want to send to my child that I am angry with, I disapprove of what you have done. Whether it is with school or whether it is in house, I'm showing my disapproval saying I don't like what you did. But I'm not boiling inside. That's the difference between internalizing it and externalizing that. Understanding gender differences will mean that boys communicate differently and girls communicate differently. We have to respect the gender differences between men, between women, between boys, between girls. It's essentially just a difference of how we communicate. If you ask your girl child how she goes to school or college and comes back, you ask her how was college today, she'll say, no, when I left the place, that lift, when I went to that lift, that auntie came into the lift. She'll start from the time she entered the lift the time she went to the college and she came back, she'll give you a 1 hour full picture of scene by scene, dialogue by dialogue of what happened. You ask your boy child, how was college today? Normal. You should. No, that's the way we communicate. You know, men have trained themselves to be hunter-gatherers, basically, right? So when we went for hunting, we could not talk and hunt. If we talked, the prey would run away. We were not bringing anything back to eat.
So we're giving excuses, Sridhar.
No, I'm saying there's an evolutionary need for that. Seriously, there was an evolutionary need for not communicating when you are working. If you look at men when they are working together, see, it's not like men are not communicating with women. Women don't communicate with men also. The same thing works. It's not like men are very communicative with other men, they're not communicative with women. It's not personal. Don't take that men are not communicating with women as a personal issue. It's the way they've evolved. When they work together, they're silently working together. You look at a bunch of men working together, there's hardly any action. Tea? Yeah. Going? Yeah. Bye? Yeah. This is how it will be, the conversation. It won't be elaborate. You need to understand the gender differences between boys, how they come and communicate to you as a counselor. You know, and as a counselor, somewhere we need to encourage boys to communicate more. You know, can we encourage them to communicate more? Can we bring out their feelings? Men don't express feelings easily as much as women express feelings. There's nothing sexist about it. It's the way we are built. Right? We tend to communicate more. Like I said, she can give you 2 pages of what happened from the time she left home. Whereas when you ask the boy, he'll say, yeah, nothing normal. How was the day? Usual, nothing different. No, that's the way we communicate. A lot of things might have happened, but somehow it doesn't stay in our head to communicate. So understand and accept gender differences in communication. This is another very important part. When you're doing school counseling work, sometimes children don't express their real feelings. Or they will not have shared the real reason why they did something. Now, this is the tricky part for you as a counselor. You know, again, it comes down to communication. How do I make them share their real feelings? You know, they have experienced something, they're just coming and sharing the superficial part of it. They're not telling you what actually they are going through. Why do you think children don't communicate their real feelings?
Consequences.
One, they have not been taught. Two, they don't know whether they'll accept it or not. Right? They don't want to be judged by you. Suppose he says, my mom did this to me at home and I don't like my mom. He doesn't know whether he can come and tell you, I don't like my mom. No, will you judge him? If he comes and says, I don't like my mom, you say, how can you not like your mom? She's after all your mom. No, this is the sentences that they get from everybody outside. He has tried it. He has gone and told an aunt or somebody, I don't like my mom. You have got all these sentences of, how can you not do this? You're not a good son if you don't do this. You have to like your mom. After all, she is your mother. All these sentences he has heard. So he has just clammed them. That the children will not express their real feelings because they're afraid of not being accepted by you. No, all of us like being accepted, isn't it? We all like to belong to the same social groups. So I always say that I don't want to convey my real feelings because I will not be accepted by this person. I'm hesitant. And I don't know whether I can disclose it to you and it will not go back to my mom. I might come and tell you that I dislike my mom, but if you go back and tell her, what will I do? Yes, Rebecca. What will I do? So I don't want to be judged by you. Right? So this is, it's very important for us. It's very important for us to help the child express his real feelings. If he doesn't express his real feelings or the real intentions behind what he's doing, you'll never be able to help him. As a counselor, you are there to help him out. It's a genuine thing. So it takes a lot of skill and practice on our side by assuring him one of confidentiality, winning him his trust over. And very importantly, don't discuss the issue at all right in the beginning. You know, often what happens is the teacher will send a boy to you saying that he had been drawing some vulgar pictures in the class. Now, in this book, I found a lot of vulgar pictures in the class. Go to the counselor. So he comes to the counselor. You have already been informed that this boy has been sent to you because he has been drawing some vulgar pictures. Now, if you start by asking him about why did you draw your vulgar pictures, you are not going to get the answer. Right? You are trying to fix the problem. When you try to fix the problem straight away, the boy is going to resist. I didn't draw anything like that. So don't discuss the issue, just build a rapport, talk to him about other things. It's not important that I solve that thing in that session. No, the teacher may be expecting that she will come and ask you also later. This has happened so many times. The teacher will send somebody to you expecting that you are going to do some miraculous work as a counselor. No, they expect a lot of miracles from counselors. They think that the moment you send to a counselor, the boy will come back all fully cleansed and fully transformed and he's a different kind of, you know, wearing a Superman coat or something like that. It doesn't work like that, isn't it? Counseling always takes time. For you, it takes time to build a rapport with the boy. So don't expect miraculous things, and you have to educate the teacher there. That I'll talk to this child, if this is a problem, I'll talk to him, but it'll take a few sessions for me to talk to him. Right? Then you build a rapport with him, talk to him about other things, and then only when you are comfortable level, then you come and discuss the issue of what is the thing that he has drawn. And often I want to tell you that teachers, parents always have exaggerate for whatever the children do. Right? If somebody is drawing something, it's not criminal to do that. At a particular age, they might do that kind of a thing. They might lie. Suppose the parent catches the child lying, they think it's a huge monstrous thing. How can my child lie? They will come running to the counselor saying she did like this or she did like that. No, we have to more counsel our parents than the children often. But what happens is we have to accept that the parent is upset. We counsel them for 3 years. You say I'll take care of it. But when it comes to the talking to the child, make the issue a secondary one. No, make the issue a secondary one. First build the rapport with the child. Only then you can come to the real issue why he is doing that. Right? If you want to change your behavior, we look at how do you modify changes in behavior. But firstly, accept that the child may not share real feelings or real issues with you. And how do you make that depends on how well you can ask the questions to the child and come out with the real feelings. I had this father who came to me. He said, my son has done his 12th standard. Right? And now he wants to do BCom. And father said, I have no hazards. He can do BCom, whatever he wants to do, I have no problem. I said, you can do BCom. But my son says, he wants to go to Delhi to do BCom. No, he wants to go to the Sri Ram College of Commerce and do BCom. So he said, I don't know why he's from Bangalore, he wants to go to Delhi and do what? BCom. Why does he have to go to Delhi to BCom? Can you talk to him? I said, yeah, I'll talk to him. And I talked to the child. And what the real reasons for him to go? So I want you to think, I want you to counsel me. You know, I want you to ask me questions to find out what is the real reason why I want to go to Delhi. Where do we start? Where do you want to go to Delhi?
Your friends are going to find out about you.
No, my friends are not going there. All my friends are studying in Bangalore only. Only I want to go to Delhi and study in Sri Ram College of Commerce.
That must be an interesting place to do BCom.
I think so.
Can I know more about Sri Ram College?
It is the number one college in India. India Today had done a survey of all the colleges and they listed Sri Ram College as the number one commerce college in India. So I want to go there for that.
Have you found out the admission procedure or how you want to go about it?
Yeah, I've got enough marks. I can get them. I found out I can go there.
Then
no, none of my friends are going to go, which I am with.
What, do you miss your family there?
Yeah, I think I might.
I don't know.
You didn't find any colleges good enough in Bangalore?
No, there are good enough colleges, but Shriram College is the number one college in India.
That's what's attractive.
It's very good that you want to study in one of the best colleges.
Thank you. Yeah, I need to go. What do you ask as counselors?
Shridhar, there are so many colleges in Bangalore.
Yeah.
Why the one in Delhi? What?
It's the number one college.
Number one. What else do you know about the college?
I don't know anything. I want to do BCom. My dad said I can do BCom. And I want to do it in Delhi.
Is your father okay to be going to Delhi?
No, he's not okay.
Has he not been doing any business
life? He says he wants you to study here, but I want to go to Delhi.
What? Have you told him why you want to go?
I told him it's the number one college, that's why I want
to. Is there any other reason why you want to go?
This is true, okay. Shushma is almost saying, can you tell me the real reason why you want to go? No, you kind of directly hit a hammer and hit it on my head and ask me.
She said, what is the real reason for going to Amazon to tell her what's the real reason?
If I tell her the real reason, she might judge me. Isn't it? She might not accept me.
What do you think would be the challenges you will face when you will go to Delhi? Have you thought about it?
Yeah, I think I can take care of it. There's a hostel and all. There are many people who are studying in Delhi. I can take care of that.
What about the expense part?
But my dad is rich, he can take care of
it. What about your maybes?
You have to make new acquaintances in Delhi. No, I'll make new friends. First, maybe rewind a little bit and try to find out who the boys and what is the college. Exactly. See, what you have done for the last 5 minutes is focus on a solution. Right? You're saying, why does he want to go to Delhi? And you're all intent on not sending me to Delhi. Is that right? You have made up your mind that this boy should not go to Delhi because the dad has said he doesn't want him to go to Delhi. You're taking the dad's side. No, what happened was, when I dig deeper, when I asked him, actually none of you reached the point of where you needed to touch on, except Pratima came very close to saying your father. No, that was a sensitive issue for me as a child. I can't get along with my dad. I just can't get along with my dad. I've been waiting to get out of the house.
I knew this.
Right?
I knew this.
You knew this, that's why you asked me for the real reason.
That is why I asked you.
No, see, what happened was, the child had this feeling that his father was very authoritative. Right? He's all the time looking into my messages, my friends. He's all over me. You know, like I can't do anything without him interfering in it. So for me, the best way is to get out of this place. And Shriram College of Commerce, number one college. Nothing to, dad can pay for it. But Delhi, I'll manage Delhi. No, that's the real reason. So unless you can take out the real reason, it takes a lot of steel, it takes a lot of patience to uncover the real reason why somebody wants to go. I'm not disclosing my feeling. What's my real feeling? My dislike for my dad is my real feeling, right? That I can't get along with my dad at the age of 17. And I'm just 17 and just can't get along with my dad. If I tell that to you, you'll say, he's your dad. You have to get along with him. He's your father after all.
No, I will never give that kind of lecture.
No, but I want to say something, bro. I've been targeting her child from the last 5 years. And since 5 years, he's been just running away. Like this only, taking up some course somewhere in Sweden.